Deacon Brothers, amen, First Lady Thomas, and all of you gathered in the presence of the Holy Trinity. Amen. We do give you all and praise. Amen. We are not going to be in your before you long. Let's go to the book of Luke, chapter 22. The book of Luke, chapter 22. We're going to begin reading at verse number 1. Amen. Let us all stand in the reverence of the word of God, please. Now the feast of unleavened bread drew nigh, which is called the Passover. And the chief priests and scribes sought how they might kill him, talking about Jesus, for they feared the people. Amen. Jesus had so much support, they didn't want to risk trying to kill him, amen, because of the people. Then entered Satan into Judas, surnamed Iscariot, being of the number of the 12. And he went his way and communed with the chief priests and captains, how might betray him unto them, how he might betray him unto them. And they were glad and covenanted to give him money. And he promised and sought opportunity to betray him unto them in the absence of the multitude. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come right now and we thank you, God, for another Sunday morning. We thank you right now that we're here among the living, oh God, and not among the dead. Oh God, we know, Heavenly Father, that there were some who laid down last night. But this morning their voices are hushed up in Zion. And Lord God, we just thank you for the opportunity to give you the praise. Oh God, we ask that you would come in right now and have your way. Use me in a supernatural way, oh God. Take this word, oh God, and deliver it to your people, oh God. To each situation, each circumstance, oh God. They need you right now. Oh God, we need you right now. We can't pray until you come. We can't sing until the Holy Ghost comes. We can't preach until the Holy Ghost comes. Move in this place today, as only you can. Oh God, we just simply thank you. We pray in advance for the move of God that's going to happen in this world. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Verse 6 says, and he promised and saw opportunity to betray him unto them in the absence of the multitude. Amen. We just want to talk to you to a little while on the subject. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God. Amen. God has made some promises. And my Bible says that he's not a man that he should lie, or a son of man that he should repent. So if he said it, he'll show up do it. Amen. 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 And so if he's made us a promise, that lets us know. And our theme this year is going to the next level in our living, giving, worship, and service. Going to the next level. And so in order to go to the next level, we must understand the concept of destiny. Amen. That God has destined for us to have some things. God has destined some places for us to go. God has destined some things for us to achieve. Amen. And we do know that our adversary, the devil, is on his job. And it is his job to try to keep us from accessing the things that God has destined for us to have. Amen, amen, amen. But as we talked on last Sunday, I don't know about you, but I'm going to fight for what the Lord has for me. Amen, amen. So when we talk about being destined for some things, one of the most tragic things that can happen to you is to live your whole life reach your destiny. God is calling us to step out on faith and walk into the destiny he has prepared for us. Jeremiah 29:11 says, For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. So God reassures us that his plans for us are good and full of prosperity. Therefore, God has already planned our destiny and provided everything we need to reach it. Now, all we have to do is take what he has given us and walk into our destiny. Somebody say, walk it out.
Walk it out.
All we have to do is walk into what God has already prepared for us. Now, this is reminiscent of the children of Israel when he told them to go into the promised land, that I've already given it into your hands. All you have to do is walk into it. And he said, every place that the soles of your feet shall tread, it shall be yours. How many of us are standing on the outside of what God has given us when he's already said, go in and take it? It's already yours. So at the time of our text, Jesus' earthly ministry is coming to an end. However, if we were to look back and characterize Jesus' ministry, we could say it was destiny being walked out. Jesus, the master teacher, teaching us how to walk out the destiny the Father has ordained for us. Now there is a difference between Jesus walking out his destiny and we walking out our destiny. When God calls us to our destiny, he gives us a glimpse or a vision of the end, showing us just enough to keep us walking toward it. Then through the uncertainty of what you will encounter along the way, he takes your successes and your failures, and in his infinite wisdom, uses both of them to bring you into your destiny. Now, that's why it's so important to read the Bible, because man will tell you when you have experienced failure and you messed up, it's over, you're done, and you're finished. Now, but the Bible speaks openly about men who messed up, but God still brought them into their destiny. Oh my God. Abraham messed up and told a lie one day, but he still went on to be known as the father of many nations. Moses messed up and killed an Egyptian soldier one day, but he still led the Israelites out of Egypt. And David messed up with Bathsheba one day, but he still went on to be known as a man after God's own heart. But what I like about David is he gave us the antidote for messing up in Psalms 51. He said, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of my salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. In other words, David was saying, Lord, I messed up, but if you clean me up, and with your Holy Spirit fill me up, I'll make my mess into a message. I don't need a platform. I don't need a pulpit. If I could just help somebody along the way. In Jesus walking out his destiny from ours is first, Jesus did fess up. The Bible makes it plain that he who knew no sin became sin for us. Secondly, there was no uncertainty in Jesus of what he had to encounter to fulfill his destiny. He knew what he would be facing. This was possible because Jesus was omniscient, which means all-knowing, because he was all man and all God. Are y'all with me today? He was 100% man and 100% God. Humanity and divinity coexisting, mortality and immortality coinciding, flesh and spirit commingling. 100% man and 100% God. Let me see if I can explain this. He was man enough to get tired one day and fall asleep and hit the part of the ship. But he was God enough to say, I'll give you rest. And he was man enough to get thirsty and sit on a well and tell the woman at the well to give me drink. But he was God enough to be living water.
Destiny
is a plan. A plan. systematic way of getting your purpose to manifest. We must understand that our plan must be centered around God's purpose for our life. Oh my God. How do I know what my purpose is? Oh my God. Amen. Wherever your passion lies, there you can find your purpose. That's why we have so many college graduates working in fields that they didn't get their degree in. They had a plan, but it wasn't centered around their purpose. They chose that field because of money, but sometimes because of notoriety, because of other extenuating circumstances. But they didn't choose the field because they had a passion in it. And since they didn't have a passion in it and it wasn't connected to their purpose, they didn't stick with that field, because you will only be fulfilled by real purpose. You will only be fulfilled by what you have a passion with. And no matter how much money they are paying, if you're not fulfilled and you don't have a passion for it, you will walk away from it because you get frustrated doing something you're not going to do. Oh my God. So at first glance, it seems like more than one plan got Jesus to his destiny. But the chief priest in our text had a plan. Satan had a plan. Judas had a plan. But don't let that fool you. There was always just one plan. The writer of Hebrews lets us know that even before the sin in the Garden of Eden, there was a plan. It says, "Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he said, sacrifices and offerings thou wouldest not, but a body thou hast prepared me. And burnt offering and sacrifices for sin thou hast no pleasure. Then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book. It is written of me to do thy will, O God." Revelation says, "The Lamb was slain before the foundation of the world." You see, before man went into sin, Jesus' destiny was set to go to the cross and bring him out of sin. Isn't that a loving God? Before you went in, there was already a plan to bring you out. The next element to get you to your destiny is you're going to need a push. What do you mean, preacher, by a push? Many times God will allow your troubles and even your enemies to push you into your destiny. This is important to know, because sometimes we will delay ourselves from reaching our destiny by wasting time trying to bind and rebuke something God has ordained for you to go through. You see, that the chief priest thought that they were using Judas. Satan thought he was using Judas, but Jesus was allowing Judas to push him into his destiny. And you see, your Judas will push you into your destiny. Joseph's brothers was his Judas. And they pushed him in a pit, but he ended up in the palace. Saul was David's Judas. He pushed him in a cave, but he ended up on the throne. Paul's thorn in the flesh was his Judas. It pushed him to write over 2/3 of the New Testament. Your Judas might be that job that pushed you out the door, but push you into a better job. Your Judas might be that person who pushed you out of their life, but they push you into the arms of somebody else. And your Judas might be the problem that pushed you on your knees, but it pushed you to another level of glory and to another level of praise. You need to stop trying to fight that battle and say, "Lord, why is this coming against me?" If you allow it to come to me, then you got a plan to use it for my life. Because I read in my Bible where it says, that he says in Romans 8:28, all things will work together for the good of them that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. I don't care Now, find the final element that will get you to your destiny is a promise. The promise of God release you from the pressure of feeling you have to get yourself to your own destiny. So many of us are frustrated and bitter because we started trying to be our own God. We started trying to make it happen ourselves. But God promises release you from the pressure of feeling you have to get yourself to your destiny. And you don't have to worry if you're going the right way. He promised if you acknowledge him, he'll direct your path. Oh my God. And you don't have to worry about who's ahead of you. He promised if you humble yourself under the hand of God, he will exalt you in due season. You don't have to worry if you're wasting a bunch of time out there in the world. He promised you he will restore the years that the canker worm and the proper worm ate up. So you ought to just sit there and praise God and say, I'm just going to stand for the promises of God. I don't care what it looks like right now. I don't care what I see right now. I'm just going to stand on the promises of God. I didn't start this, so I don't have to finish it. My Bible says he who started a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ.
Promise in Christ, I have a gift.
and not by sight. Walk by faith and not by sight. Stand on the promise of God. Sometimes you can't trust what you even see. With our natural life, with our natural, you can't trust what you see. We get ready to celebrate Easter, and on that Good Friday, it looked like Jesus was defeated. It looked like he had met his demise. It looked like the enemy had won. It looked like Satan had the victory. It looked like we were going to be lost in our sins. It looked like we were going to be lost without a Savior. It looked like that hell had won. But early on that Sunday morning, Jesus got us all power in his hand. Satan was confused. Stay true.